I'm Stephanie Rossow. I'm a veterinary diagnostician at the Minnesota Veterinary Diagnostic Lab from the University of Minnesota. I've been a swine pathologist for approximately 27 years and interact with clients' pigs and their samples every day.
My name is Jerry Torrison. I'm the director of the Minnesota Veterinary Diagnostic Lab, and we are here today to talk about the diagnostic approaches and the capabilities of veterinary diagnostics labs for diagnosing African swine fever. There are some challenges associated with African swine fever, both in terms of the biology and the regulations tied to African swine fever, and so those are the topics that we hope to cover here in this segment. So, Dr. Rossow, help us appreciate some of the challenges with diagnosing African swine fever.
The challenges are pretty common to practitioners and producers in that they see them every day with most diseases. African swine fever causes a high fever, can cause sudden death, it causes inflammation of blood vessels, which can result in a lot of the gross lesions you may see involving the spleen, the kidneys, and other tissues. Unfortunately, there's nothing characteristic for African swine fever infection that will say this is African swine fever. The other consideration is you may see pictures in textbooks from laboratories of the severe lesions that you see with African swine fever. It's what pathologists are really, focus on. This looks really cool. But unfortunately, with pigs in production, there are different strains. You may not see African swine fever in a fulminant severe form. Most commonly, you'll probably see other infections with it, so Haemophilus parasuis, Streptococcus suis. They may come across as pigs with a pleuritis, arthritis, and again, there may not be gross lesions typical of African swine fever. You can see some of the same lesions with PERS, with PCVAD, porcine circovirus associated disease, erysipelas, Salmonella cholera suis, a lot of different febrile diseases in pigs, and so it can be difficult to look at a pig and say this is something that should be suspect of African swine fever. Clinically, for naive pigs, they get the severe form, you probably get a presentation of a high death loss, and so high death loss and a high fever is a prompt for other diseases too, but should be a prompt for people to consider African swine fever.
So in a scenario where there is suspicion of African swine fever or other potential foreign animal disease threats, there are protocols in place that require the attendant or the veterinarian to contact an animal health official. So we actually can only accept at the diagnostic lab samples from a foreign animal disease diagnostician. In the case of African swine fever, that would be a whole blood sample that we would test by PCR. And the good news is, if we get a sample within a four-hour period, we can report out a plus or minus, a positive or negative result. So the turnaround time is quite rapid for a PCR test. But we are limited in our lab to only being able to test whole blood samples. And so feed screening, for example, is something that people are asking about, or other tissue samples. Those can only be tested at the Plum Island USDA laboratory facility. And so other laboratories around the U.S. actually are not allowed to test for African swine fever from other samples. I don't know if you wanted to comment on any other diagnostic approaches that might be pertinent when we're trying to understand what's going on with, say, a high mortality situation.
So a lot of the responses to a high mortality syndrome, not uncommon for someone to contact me either by phone or email or text and say, this is going on, what should I collect, what type of samples should I send in, what are some of the diagnostic considerations for this. And so you get these phone calls most every day, every other day, on what should I submit. And so the people at the D-Lab are always available for consultation directly from the field, from Barnes. And the other point is that sometimes people get excited and it's at, who do I contact, what do I do? And so certainly they can call us and say, what do I do, what do I send in, who do I call, that type of situation. So the sample type that we want for ASF PCR testing is a whole blood sample. And there's a couple different ways to submit whole blood samples. Most commonly, people are familiar with the purple top tubes, which are EDTA tubes, or the green top tubes, which are heparinized tubes. Heparin can cause some PCR inhibition, and so we really want or expect people to send the blood samples in with an EDTA / purple top tube.
So one of the features of foreign animal disease testing is how the information is managed. And so we are part of the USDA National Animal Health Laboratory Network. As part of that network, we have tests that are specifically validated by USDA to be run at what we call these NALN labs. NALN is the National Animal Health Laboratory Network. So we have specified reagents. Our technicians are checked. Each of them has to pass each test that they run on the equipment that we use. And so it's a very standardized protocol. Everyone has to pass the test that they're running. So then we get a sample in and we test it. If we have a negative result, we can report that result out. At the same time, we are electronically messaging that to the NALM network. And so the labs are connected by their information system structures so that we can electronically message that information so there's no delay in the reporting of the results. So a negative gets reported as a negative. If it's a positive, we don't report it as a positive per se. We say that we have a non-negative result. That information is also forwarded to USDA. In the meantime, there is a duplicate sample that the foreign animal disease diagnostician would have collected. That sample is being transported to the Plum Island Laboratory, the USDA laboratory in Plum Island. While that is in transit, we're doing our testing. If there's a positive or a negative result, the lab confirms either. The positive isn't reported out as positive until Plum Island has tested that sample. And so the network of laboratories, 10 of them that can run the African swine fever test out among the different states, those results are obviously very important because of the time sensitivity of it, but the confirmation then relies on the Plum Island testing. And then the USDA has the obligation to report that to the OIE. And so that's the reporting mechanism. We report our result to the USDA. They confirm the test result at the Plum Island lab. Any positive results are then the responsibility of the USDA to report to the OIE. So very structured, very standardized, very much run by standard operating procedures.
One thing to maybe to add to that is in the reporting is there's the federal state reporting that Jerry talked about, but we're not going to leave the veterinarian hanging, waiting for contact from USDA or the state. Most commonly probably me or perhaps Jerry, we'll give the veterinarian a call, let them know what's going on so they aren't blindsided by an unexpected result. So we always going to keep them in the loop to make sure everyone is informed about what's going on.
I'd like to review a little bit the contact mechanism for suspicion of a foreign animal disease. So producers talking to the veterinarians. Veterinarians can always contact the lab. We would include animal health officials at that point, or the veterinarians can call the state or federal animal health officials directly. And so this is specific to Minnesota. I don't know about other states. There is something called the Minnesota State Duty Officer, and so I keep that phone number handy at all times, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. They can be reached by phone, and then they know how to track down whoever would be on call, both at the state and the federal level. And so for any animal health emergency, that's a very important number for veterinarians to have on hand. And again, I don't know the situation in other states necessarily, but I would imagine there may be similar avenues for contact elsewhere. Maybe describe if somebody from another country, for example, wanted to submit samples to us because they were concerned about African swine fever. Are there any restrictions that we would have in terms of being able to process samples from another country?
So the answer for that is easy. We can't test samples from other countries for foreign animal diseases. So we can't test for ASF, we can't test for foot and mouth disease, we can't test for classical swine fever, and then potentially other diseases we don't have in the continental U.S. We get tissues periodically from overseas if we have the appropriate USDA permits, which sometimes includes unfixed tissues as well as formalin fixed tissues. But again, there is one sample type, the whole blood sample, that is accepted for ASF testing, and we can't officially make a diagnosis based on anything else.
And we should point out that the USDA laboratory at Plum Island does have the capability of testing other samples,
yes,
but we do not. And so there are resources available for some of the other testing. And it probably bears clarifying that the USDA permits for samples to come in to the University of Minnesota Veterinary Diagnostic Lab are dictated by the disease status of the country of origin. So if a country is known with FMD or CSF or other diseases, that would restrict it most likely to only be fixed tissues that would be available to be submitted. So those could be evaluated histologically. So how definitive can histologic lesions be as a diagnostic tool for discriminating among these different diseases?
For histopathology, you're looking at tissues under the microscope. As I mentioned with the gross lesions, differential diagnoses, there are also other disease, PERS, PCVAD, erysipelas, seminal collar suis, so the things that we mentioned before, that can overlap and cause similar lesions in pigs. And since most pathologists in the U.S. don't have a daily exposure to African swine fever or the diseases it or the lesions it causes, probably not going to be terribly adept at the nuances that we sometimes use to get suspicious of something different. And so that can also be, that would be a challenge to getting a clue just from tissues that there's a foreign animal disease.
So relying on gross lesions, clinical signs, and even histopathology is not going to be precise enough in terms of diagnosing African swine fever. The good news is we have a very sensitive and specific PCR test that we can run on whole blood. The USDA lab has serology tests that they can run to look for antibodies in serum, but that's not a tool that's available out at the National Animal Health Laboratory Network labs outside of the Plum Island lab.
Yeah, I guess one thing that troubles me and frightens me about this is that if we have introduction of African swine fever, for example, in southern Minnesota, northern Iowa, there's going to be lots and lots of resources dedicated to African swine fever testing. For the people that aren't affected, our ability to respond to all the diseases that we normally test for may be compromised. We may not be able to test for everything. And so helping people that don't have ASF maintain the health of their herd and keeping ASF diagnostics up and going in a timely manner will be very challenging.
I guess I would summarize by saying that we're ready to do the testing. We have protocols in place. We have trained people. We have the equipment. We actually have a very large capacity to be able to test many samples. At some point, it can outstrip the capacity to do everything. And so there are continuity of business plans for movement of pigs, for movement of feed, other things that the national organizations have been working on. There is also a surge capacity built into the National Animal Health Laboratory Network in which samples can be shifted from lab to lab in order to meet the challenges of testing. And since none of this has happened, I guess we have recent experience with PED to understand how the ramp up can look. Obviously, the hope is that we never experience anything like an African swine fever outbreak. But there will be many lessons learned very quickly that might affect how testing is done, what other testing is not done, but at least in the initial stages, we're well prepared for the testing that is expected, and then we'll have to figure out where we go from there.
In addition, people should also realize or know that the Minnesota VDL is always essentially open for questions people may have about African swine fever or other diseases. They can contact us most any time of the day, either by phone calls, emails. Lots of people have my personal phone number, text, and so if it's important for the client, for important for the producer, it's important for us, and we can be found and help you out as fast as possible.
Don't send in green, send in purple. Go Vikings.
I want to comment on that. Go Packers.